the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.
Join us in our design movement.
Welcome to the 10th edition of MIT webinar series. I am Professor Sameer Shitut, Head of Retail and Exhibition Design at MIT Institute of Design. In this edition of webinar, we are going to discuss about impact of retail design. And we have with us Mr. Pushkar, who is a creative director at Showbiz Experiential Communication and has an extensive experience in designing strategies, UI UX, branding, retail, space, and experience. Welcome, Pushkar.
Thank you.
So to begin with, firstly, I would like to know how and when you started retail design.
I'm a trained product designer, to be honest. I started out in times when there was no retail courses. I think I secretly wanted to be an architect.
Okay. You
know, and after graduation, I was working in Delhi with this genius called Niladri Mukherjee. He's, I believe, one of the pioneers of retail design in India. And we started out doing a lot of exhibitions and lot of brand spaces. These were times where mostly clients used to brief us saying, dukaan ka interior karna hai. You know, so Niladri was one of the first people to realize this connection between a brand, a space, and a built brand experience.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a huge learning. You know, and it was just by accident during those times when I bumped into film and television. I did reality series, this multiple Emmy award winning series called Amazing Race for 12 seasons. I was the production designer on all the franchise shows for Norway, Israel, Australia, China, and okay, forgot the last one. And I taught here. It's great to be back. And then I went back to the industry, and now I design, I do what is essentially called brand experience spaces. So that has been my trajectory. And what I've actually done is I've used my product design and material and construction skills into brands and brand spaces. So that has been my retail journey, so to speak.
Wow. So according to you, like, what are the fundamentals of retail design?
The ability to work like a dog, to be honest. jokes apart, it's like the culmination of every possible design discipline, because it has elements of architecture, it has elements of interior design, branding, and therefore obviously graphics. And now that we are increasingly to very tech driven times, it has elements of UI, VR. We do a lot of projects in Showbiz that have a huge influx of technology into them. For example, we did the car launch for the Renault Kwid, wherein we couldn't show the car. The car hadn't officially launched at that point of time. So the entire launch touch point for consumers was done on VR.
Wow.
So that is one major technology shift that is happening. So if you were to say, what are the basic fundamentals of skill sets that you would need for retail, I would assume that it includes every design skill that you possibly have. Because retail also touches into not just, let's say, the shop build,
mm-hmm.
but it's also now every point that a brand may possibly touch,
correct.
Both online and offline.
Yeah.
So your retail space may be it may be an exhibition, it may be a pop-up, it may be a museum. Because a lot of these very legacy brands like Mercedes, BMW or Skoda have very, very elaborate, well-built, well-designed and a lot of it experiential museums back in their country of origin. So there is no real, I wouldn't be able to actually pinpoint and be exact and say, okay, this is where retail ends. Because the possibilities are now endless because there is so much you can do with technology now.
Correct.
Combined with traditional technology.
Yeah. And what is the importance of retail design in the industry, according to you?
Well, it's a, to be honest, we are a trading economy, right? The entire world is now a trading entity because you have goods built in China that are sold across the world and while you have design to build and make and manufacture the product, you also need design to help make the sale, to be able to convince buyers, you know, and it's a very challenging proposition when you have a space, brick and mortar and maybe even virtual, you know, to be able to convince a buyer to be able to buy a product. I will again go back to the Renault experience, you know, it's a virtual build of a car. There's no car in front of you. You can't take a test drive physically. So the entire experience was virtual, you know, and at first, to be honest, as a designer, I was pretty skeptical as to how an Indian buyer would go about doing that, you know. So to be able to actually define various mediums to convince a consumer, you know, that A, this is a brand, this is a product or a service, and this makes sense for you, you know, and well, retail design comes in there, and to be able to convince a set of audiences that this is the best product for you, or this is the best service for you, you know, and without doing it unethically.
Correct.
Right? Because while you could always convince somebody to buy something that is not good for you, but if you are able to do that, I mean, people would love that.
Great.
Brands would love that.
So when you started retail design, like how much it has changed over a period of time, like what retail design is today?
See, the basic elements still remain in place, the concept of buying and selling, the basic proposition remains the same. What has happened in recent times, especially in the last 4 or 5 years, is this big technology shift.
Mm-hmm.
And also this wherein we are going into, you know, AI driven solutions, or we are looking into artificial spaces, virtual spaces. We are also looking at the entire world being, you know, condensed into devices, and they have become your Play Store.
Correct.
You know, or the entire buying experience is there on your fingertips.
Yeah.
The banking economy has been altered to help people drive this concept of retail forward. So there is a technology shift. But the basic proposition of buying and selling has not changed. The mediums have changed, and increasingly that is what will change. You know, the concept of how well you use traditional media and able to combine that with future tech and be able to sell, make it easier for people to buy and sell. Let's, for example, I saw this example in Korea where a person could leave your office and they had this entire product category in right on the subway escalator. You use your device is your selector module. You select what you want to buy, you make the payment on your phone right then. By the time you've reached home, the product is delivered.
Wow.
Right, so it has made your life simpler.
Correct.
Right, more than, and maybe this is just not limited to groceries, maybe this is just not limited to essential items. You know, if you look at it, a large part of our changing buying and selling pattern is online. Fashion is now online. Groceries are now online. I believe now the government is making provisions where you can buy fuel online and it will be delivered to your home.
Okay.
So, you know, I have my veterinary, I have that you can call online. You have a plumber that you can call online. I can't really think of any service that you can't do anything on a device now. So that is one major shift.
Okay, great. So now, as you know, like India is like the third biggest market for retail sector.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
It's a great time to be a retail designer.
Exactly, exactly. So, according to you, when the brands, the global brands, a lot of international brands are coming into Indian market. So, what is that actually change or approach which they come with? Because Indian market is totally different and it's quite complex. So, how do they connect with the local trends here?
See, our experience of the retail process has been always mostly multi-brand retail. I mean, traditionally, what has been the Kirana experience, what the industry calls mom and pop stores.
Correct.
Where one shop, you are able to buy everything.
Right.
Right. The foreign entries have brought high value retail and essentially single point retail into India. So if you look at all the H&M's, all the Zara's, all the Gucci's and Tod's and what have you, the biggest influx has been stores that include the buying experience in something into a holistic experience. So let's say, for example, you bought a product, but then that experience has extended into a post-buy experience wherein there are offers and there are subsequent products that are pushed into that experience that have already undergone. For example, you buy a shoe, but then there are suggestions built to prolong that experience.
Yeah.
And to be able to retain you with the brand, right? The ability to make you not migrate into other brand. And believe me, the seduction is huge because every brand is trying to retain its customer core base.
Exactly.
So everybody is trying to do the same thing. But what has been one of the biggest learnings that I have personally experienced is this amazing ability that they have brought to target very particular customers very successfully. To be able to define, let's say, an 18 to 35 year old and say, okay, this is the color for him, this is the material for him, this is the palette for him. Because what they have brought is them with this amazing retail methodology.
Yes.
To be able to identify audiences, to define an experience for that audience, and invariably it is absolutely bang on.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Since you mostly work with international brand, I guess, like
A lot of we work in possibly all verticals from banking and finance to automotive to FMCG to consumer goods to fashion, lately even television. And yes, a lot of our clientele, especially in the auto sector, they are mostly international clients, and they have brought this amazing experience, and it is always a new learning,
Exactly.
Because we think, I believe the Indian audience is unique, but that methodology that they brought is pretty helpful for designers to be able to tap on and to be able to even make forecasts.
Yes.
Right, because a lot of our work that we do has a landing time of, let's say, 2 to 3 months. What you design today has resonance next week or next month or 3 months down the line. And I always find it pretty, exciting as to how it actually translates on the ground and to be able to see key, the backstory of the design actually works out very well.
Wow. So as you said, like you worked with a lot of international brands, and in India, retail has been like last 2 decades, we are seeing that shift. So what is the impact of that into Indian retail scenario?
There is definitely competition to begin with.
Okay.
Not just from the buying selling experience, but also from the design experience.
Mm-hmm.
Because that has forced a lot of Indian brands to really amp up their retail presence.
Yeah.
A very good example is one of my favorite spots, which is Foodall.
Foodall.
It's a completely indigenous brand.
Yes.
Run by the Future Group. And they have this retail concept called Foodall, wherein you get the most amazing foods of the world.
Yes.
And it's an experience. I find, because A, for me, food hall is right down the street. That's where you'll find me on Sundays for my morning coffee. But what I find really amazing is how they have tapped the audience.
Yes.
They have tapped absolutely the right audience in the right space, in the right placement, with the right positioning.
Correct.
You couldn't have asked for it better. But if you look at the holistic design experience there, talk about color, talk about material, talk about architectural flows, talk about the in-shop experience, talk about the payment experience. You know, everything has been designed to sync with that audience. And I believe it's one of the most successful retail stories in India, at least from a design perspective, from a consumer experience, because I have stopped going there from a designer experience. It's more from a Sunday morning experience, which I absolutely love. And I believe that would have been slightly late in the day had a lot of these international brands not arrived a couple of years ago.
Okay.
Because you have to create your space in this extremely crowded market.
Correct.
If you look at any vertical, you look at the banking sector, if you look at the automotive sector, you look at the FMCG sector, there is a huge churn for brand space, for brands to stand out.
Correct.
For brands to distinguish among themselves.
Right.
You know, and design is what is leading this churn. Design helps brands make space for themselves, to be able for consumers to be able to see them in this extremely crowded market space.
Right.
And design has built devices across, I would say, mediums, whether it's TV, whether it's moving pictures, whether it's imagery, whether it's through material, whether it's through the online, offline experience, you name it. That has been the single biggest drive to change
the Indian retail.
In the Indian retail.
Great. Actually, that's what I was going to ask you. Like, last few years, we have seen a tremendous growth in online shopping, and a lot of people prefer online shopping. So, according to you, that what are the other emerging trends in retail?
Well, technology is here to stay. Technology is definitely not going out anytime now. But what will happen now is that your retail experience will get more efficient. It will get more faster. See, the thing is, now you have extremely efficient devices. You know, you have, and whether we like it or not, the shopping experience has moved on to your device.
Yes.
Right. It has made a lot of our lives very simpler. We live extremely busy lives. You know, not to overlook the fact that cities are now extremely crowded, and to be honest, going to an actual shop space or to a retail space these days involves planning. It involves wading through traffic. It involves fighting for parking space. These things make it very simple and very, very convenient for various audiences. And now if you look at technology being pushed by other technologies like 3G, 4G, 5G, it'll get even more efficient, wherein you will be able to experiment, let's say, with, right now, Amazon has an entire shopping experience on a device. With better streaming technologies, how about the entire VR experience in your home? You know, you're able to, let's say, if you want to buy something, can I recreate that, or visualize that scenario of the product or the context of the product that I'm buying it for at my personal
convenient,
level, convenience. Yeah. Because see, finally what happens is, if you look at it, most of the things that we buy online are something that do not require touch feel. It's something that we've experienced before.
Correct.
Right. We still prefer buying at the shop.
Yes.
Where we have a tactile experience, a visual experience with the product. I feel that at some point the technology will bridge this gap. Right? And that makes it more interesting for a designer. You know?
Yeah.
Augmented reality is already here. Right? And we've already used augmented reality in a lot of our spaces. And what's to prevent augmented reality to not enhance your buying experience at home? To be able to be anywhere and have that experience, you know, and bring that tactileness at your, I mean, I wouldn't even call it a doorstep now, because the doorstep is pretty redundant. We can do it while we are sitting.
Sitting right now, correct. So, as you said, like, we all are surrounded by technology, and brands are also using it quite smartly to attract the customers, engage them, and to increase sales, of course. So, according to you, what could be the impact of the technology in the future?
Technology will always be a driver. See, I have this very strong feeling that you cannot take the software aspects of brand and communication and retail away and say, oh, technology is going to take everything up. I mean, it's not. I remember there was this film, Terminator. The first Terminator, when it came, it said, in 2000, you know, the world will, robots will take over, kill everyone, and humanity is dead. You know, I just saw the latest sequel of Terminator, which is now set in 2049 or something like that. All of us are still here. Sorry. So in that respect, technology will always be a driver. It will always be a medium of efficiency. You know, but the basic tenets of brand, product, retail, consumership will not change.
Okay.
You know, very interestingly, I was at Auto Expo last week, and we designed the Skoda stalls, and we were the logistic partner for the Volkswagen stall. While Volkswagen was presenting its entirely futuristic line of automobiles, which is all electric, all efficient, possibly even driverless, a driverless future.
Mm-hmm.
But what Volkswagen inaugurated their exhibition saying, do you notice anything different? What Volkswagen did was, they rebranded that entire Volkswagen identity and communication to fit to the new future, to this new set of futuristic, or rather future consumers, which are essentially very young people. And so, I mean, their entire communication is now just color, right? It's color, it's pop, it's bright, it's young, it's vibrant. But it's also electric. It's possibly also driverless, right? So while the human elements are all in place, the technology has been added into the human element. So I really don't see an either or situation. You know, human elements will still remain in place.
Yes.
Technology will be an added factor into that humanist element.
So according to you, that user will be the center of...
Absolutely, always. The user cannot be not present in any retail experience. Who will you sell to? You're finally selling it to a person.
Correct.
A audience, a customer segment, right? If that a person is not there, then you don't have a customer.
Yeah.
If you don't have a customer, then you don't have retail.
Exactly. Wow. It was interesting to see your thoughts, listen to your thoughts, and we'll move on to the questionnaire session now.
Sure.
So we have some questions coming. So Sahil wants to know that what is the difference between Indian and foreign retail scenario?
Is this question from a customer experience or from a design experience? Because there are two aspects to this.
Okay.
So from a customer experience, I wouldn't really say that, you know, there is any real difference as customers, because to be honest, the Indian customer is now extremely mature. He's extremely well traveled, he earns well, he's extremely aware of all global trends, all fashion trends, of all technology trends. So from a buying experience, he has more buying power now. We have almost all of the world's leading brands in India right now, and you can choose from in fashion, from Zara to a Nike to an Under Armour to you name it. And from vehicles, if you look around, you have Nissan to Volkswagen to Suzuki, everybody is here.
Yes.
Right, but so I wouldn't say there is a real perceptible difference when it comes to the retail that is abroad and retail in India, because finally the products that are sold there are products that are sold here as well.
Yeah.
It's just that we are a very nitpicky audience, I would say. You know, we like a lot of say in our buying. The Indian audience is very discerning. I think it's from the multi-brand experience wherein, you know, we have a lot of offerings available to us and we like to see the pros and cons of everything before we buy. But that is also pertinent to a certain generation. I am seeing also generations that are extremely impulsive.
Yeah.
And brands are tapping into that as well. But right. To answer your original question, I really don't see, from a consumer standpoint as well as a design standpoint, I don't see any difference in retail abroad or retail India. Because a lot of, you look at Indian retail design, it's on par with what is happening in the rest of the world. A lot of work that we do is extremely global. A lot of work that my peers, a lot of ex-students that are in leading design agencies and studios are doing some extremely great work that is globally recognized. And it's not, they're working with international teams from India. So to answer your question, yes, I don't think there's any difference.
Great. Second is, now Yash wants to know that technology would take over most sectors. So what, according to you, would be the situation of offline retail?
Offline retail will not go anywhere. I can bet my last dollar on it. I see, we are a very, very, very unique country in that respect. And for that matter, a lot of Asia is. Because see, at one point, if you get out of 3 kilometers outside of where we are sitting right now, there's a market that happens every Saturday.
Yeah.
Local producers come and you get fresh produce.
Yes.
Which in cities now is incidentally called farmers markets.
Yeah.
Right? And it has a very upscale, very organic look and feel to it, and things are exorbitantly priced and so on and so forth. But it's the same concept. So your, what is traditionally a concept of a village heart has not gone anywhere. But it's coexisting in multi and single brand, extremely high-end retail, just 200 kilometers from it. Right? Wherein, and you, if you really look at it, a lot, even though a lot of it is retail, we still buy certain products the old-fashioned way.
Hmm.
We like to go and touch things. We like to go and smell things. More important, we like to go and see what we are buying and not have a surprise delivered to us by a delivery guy.
Correct.
That apart, it's always a reassuring thing when you buy things right in front of you. There are certain things that I agree are much more convenient to buy online, but that's only limited to certain kind of products and services.
Right.
And technology, as I said earlier, will always be a driver. It will not take over retail ever. That's my firm belief. We will still be designing brick and mortar stores at some point in the near and far medium future. I wouldn't be able to predict what will happen in the next 50 years, but because, global warming is killing everyone. But at least in the medium future, short term and medium future, I don't see brick and mortar going away or taking over. And the same thing for technology taking over everything. Technology will still be a driver.
Thank you. Next question is from Amish. He wants to know what design services a retail designer provide.
Design services, I mean, that's every brand touch point. So right from retail stores to warehouses to exhibitions to pop retail, pop-up stores to activations to experiential events to museums, the list is endless. Like if you take the lifespan of a product like a car has to be designed for a consumer. A car has to be sold. These days you can sell a car online and both in shop, right? But we never buy a new car online. There are some, we've tried that. To be honest, one of the projects that we've done for Renault was an e-experience.
Okay.
Where we decided to relook the entire car buying experience. Yeah. I'll go into the details later.
Yeah.
But a car has been designed to be sold to a consumer, right? So you will need a space for that sale.
Yeah.
Once the car has been sold, there might be a need to promote that car for different audiences, different regions, different markets. So there will be a retail activation push for that. So their design comes in, right? There are situations where you might need the car to engage with different markets and different audiences, right? And these necessarily don't have to be in showrooms. These days, manufacturers have decided to take the product to where the consumer is. So it could be a flea market fair for all you know,
yeah.
Right? So design comes in there. So you see, at every stage of the car's life, there is a brand engagement touch point.
Correct.
The same car manufacturer also has a very elaborate and very enriching museum experience, you know, which reinforces your engagement with the brand. So I never know how long you can extend that consumer experience, right? That engagement with the brand. And it's not necessarily limited to that product. Brands are increasingly fighting for time with consumer to remain, to capture that customer for long periods of time. Why do you want to lose him to another brand? I would much rather have him engaged to go on to another offering that I have.
Right.
You know, so there is no end to, I can't really say, okay, this is where it ends. This could be where it ends. Like, for example, we designed this particular car brand. It's an international car brand. Right now they have presence only in the metros. But there's a large part of India in tier 2 and tier 3 cities that have affordances for that particular product. So this manufacturer, this brand, reached out to them. So we designed an entire showroom that moves. So it's a showroom on a flatbed truck that goes to tier 2 and tier 3 cities. So if the mountain can't come, then the mountain will come to you.
Great. So next question is how retail design is different from interior design? Kavita is asking the question.
It has elements of interior design in it. It has what retail design differs from interior design primarily is the concept of brand and the brand communication. A lot of interior design may not have this element, and I stress on the fact may, because interior design could also span my bedroom.
Yeah.
Right. I can also argue that I am the brand there, and therefore it needs to communicate me. But that said, the brand and the brand engagement is always what makes it different from, let's say, an interior design.
Okay. Next question we have is from Amrita. Which are the popular Indian companies that hire retail designers? I mean, this is a very...
Oh, can I do a showbiz plug here? We hire a lot of designers.
Okay.
Just to give you a background, now we are part of the third largest media group in the world, the Havas Media Group.
Okay.
So we are an international firm now. We work on probably 3,000 projects a year. And all of it is at least some form of brand touch point or the other.
Okay.
So we very actively hire retail designers. That said, there are a lot of both homegrown indigenous studios who are doing extremely well in India. There's a couple of them in Bangalore called Restore Solutions. There is 4D, there is Fitch in Bombay, there is also Idea Spice, there is Lotus in Delhi who do some very, very incredible work. There are also studios in Ahmedabad, I don't recall the names. And yeah, so there is a huge proliferation of both international and domestic studios and design agencies in India that one can work with.
Okay.
And increasingly what is happening is there is this slow realization, a gradual realization that retail, you can't box design into compartments anymore, because brands now work on a 360 degree outreach, on a 360 degree engagement with consumers. So increasingly studios who have traditionally also been doing, let's say, graphic design for a period of time have slowly coming to a conclusion that graphic design is just a part of the retail and brand touch point.
Yes.
And it becomes important to extend that brand, that particular design communication into other areas as well. So it's also very surprising in a nice way to see specialized studios also in making forays into retail design.
Okay.
So the bandwidth of studios now is being enhanced to incorporate elements of retail design.
Okay, interesting. Next question is from what type of jobs does Indian retail industry offer today?
Retail designers. You're a retail designer.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of what is the profile they're looking for?
So the profile, you join as a retail designer, but you might not be thrown into the deep end of a retail project yet till such time, because clients are extremely demanding. We have extremely short deadlines. So one builds gradually into the system.
Yeah.
So a lot of designers, when they graduate and join as interns, they'll probably get to do a lot of research work. They get to do a lot of the back end work that helps into making a comprehensive design solution for a client. Things like research, things like ideation, things like brainstorming. You know, because it's never, you can't really say whether, you know, a good idea may not come out of an intern.
Yes.
Because every mind thinks differently. You get sometimes brilliant solutions out of interns. Yeah, right? But after which you have more experienced people who would translate that idea into real world renders, because a client will finally see what it actually looks like in real time material, in real lighting, in real renditions of space, real renditions of geography, so on and so forth. So over a period of time, that intern starts developing into a full-fledged retail designer. And after that, when you move up in scale, then you become an art director, then you become a design director, you become a creative director, and so on and so forth.
Great. And according to you, what are the key softwares which retail designers should know?
So like I said, you need to do everything to be a retail designer, from graphics to furniture to carpentry to, you know, fabrication to product design. So with that kind of background, you need to be pretty good with all kinds of software, both 2D and 3D. I personally work on 3D Max, Photoshop, Illustrator, but my team back home works on Maya, SketchUp, on Dreamweaver because of FutureTech. We work on V-Ray, we work on all sorts of rendering softwares, not to mention the entire suite of offerings that Adobe has, plus a legacy software called CorelDRAW.
Mm-hmm.
Because the entire print industry loves CorelDRAW.
Yeah, interesting. Ashish wants to know that what type of exhibitions can a retail designer handle?
That depends on how good you are entirely. See, because to be honest, like for example, we just concluded the Skoda exhibition at the Auto Expo in Delhi, and it involved a team of 4 designers and 2 renderers, one person who translated the entire design on AutoCAD in terms of its dimensionality, and a couple of graphic designers. So in all, that would be a team of 10 people. That would include designers, graphic designers, space designers, conceptualizers, ideators. But then I also have people back home who work on individual projects as well. And it depends entirely on scale. The Skoda exhibition was approximately 1,500 square meters. So it had a lot of complexity in terms of the number of cars that would be displayed, the kind of engagement activities that would happen there. It had a very large moving content, so there was the logistics of screens, etc., and that explained the large teams. But then you also have people who would deliver a 35,000 square foot experience for OnePlus, and that's just one person doing it. So it entirely depends on capability, experience, and skill.
Okay. Cool. Next, Kothari wants to know that how easy or difficult is it to move from retail design to exhibition or set design or museum design once you start working in the industry?
I had a if I go back to my personal experience, I had a very traumatic experience with set design.
Okay.
I was doing spaces, and one of my seniors who used to work with this very well-known theater television personality who used to do quiz shows, he decided to move abroad to study theater, and the cinematographer called me up and said, you design spaces, so why can't you design sets?
Mm-hmm.
Except that I didn't realize that sets you design for camera.
Okay.
So your visualizing has to be entirely for camera. So I designed this massive space wherein you could only see color blocks when you are looking through camera, and I had to scale the entire thing down overnight so that we could start shooting in the morning.
Okay.
But once you get the basic concept of it, I don't think there is any real difficulty in switching from, let's say, an exhibition to a set for film or television. Both have different processes, I would agree, because film has its own creative process in terms of the context. The exhibition also had a huge technical and conceptual journey, but the basic element of design does not change. If you're a retail designer, you understand the concept of brand, you understand the concept of brand communication, you understand the concept of what you're trying to sell to a certain audience, and the same concepts apply in filmmaking as well, because even television and film has an audience, right? That has a context. Maybe it has a historical context, or maybe it has a reality concept, or maybe it has a fictional concept. But the essential concept of something that is being sold to an audience still persists. So at the end of the day, it's probably just a little bit of experience that counts for that switch from, let's say, exhibition design to designing branded environments to filmmaking.
Okay. Okay, this question is for the department. Richa wants to know what aspects of retail design do your course cover?
I think it covers everything. It begins with the manipulation of spaces so that one understands how you tweak a space for certain objectivity. It has courses that cover the entire gamut or spectrum of retail design, right from museum design to design for visual merchandising to designing for, the basic retail space, both large format and small format. It does have a module on designing for film, which is set design. It has and a course which is the culmination of the entire 4-year course called systems design, which is the most elaborate course that you get, wherein the student is, I believe, able to choose an area of specialization and work on that over 6 weeks, 4 weeks.
Yeah, eight weeks.
8 weeks. So it covers the entire span of a branded environment experience.
Okay. Well, that's all. And it was nice talking to you.
Yeah, it's nice talking to you as well.
Thanks for coming.
Always.
And I would also like to thank the participants for their questions and showing interest. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
I make the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.